Welcome to the Toronto Real Estate Podcast. In today's episode, we're discussing seven effective questions to ask when hiring a listing agent. With Toronto real estate's market turbulent due to high interest rates, fluctuating home prices, inflation, negative media, and inventory challenges, it's hard to know where to go when considering making one of the biggest financial moves in highly uncertain times. Choosing the right listing agent is more critical than ever and could be the difference between success and failure. A skilled agent can help navigate these complexities and avoid pitfalls to ensure the best possible outcome. I am Corey Marin. I am the co-founder and broker at Fox Marin. And this is my partner in crime over here, Mr. Ralph Fox, broker of record and co-founder at Fox Marin. And we are thrilled to be having this conversation with you today. Good morning, everyone.
Well, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, depending upon when you're watching this. But irrespective, we're so happy that you could join us on this awesome, awesome topic.
Well, I would like to make a massive caveat here before we jump into everything, is that because I'm having my blood test today, I have not had coffee and I have not eaten. So if I say anything ridiculous or I seem a little bit woozy, everyone will give me a pass card on that, just in case.
Awesome. I'm giving you one too.
Awesome. All right. Well, let's jump into it. So we're going to really break this down into seven essential questions. So we'll make sure that the questions themselves are outlined in the podcast notes below so that you have them as a frame of reference. Ralph is going to dive into the questions, and then we're going to break down what results you're looking for on the other end from your potential listing agent.
Awesome. So without further ado, let's get into it. Question number one. What is your pricing methodology and strategic approach to pricing, and why?
This is probably the biggest thing that you need to be working through with your potential listing agent, hands down. So you want a listing agent that can, first of all, answer this question and then back it up. So there's a few things that you'll want to go through with your potential listing agent when it comes to this topic, but pricing is not something you draw from, you know, a hat, like a lottery. You want to have a pricing strategy that is based on what's happening in your local neighborhood and what's happening overall in the market. So for example, there's things that you want this potential agent to be showcasing to you or showing you, which is some sort of pricing analysis. They've looked at comps. They've looked at what's currently on the market. They've looked at what's sold and not sold. They are taking into account how much inventory is out there in your category of sale. And they're also considering price appreciation year over year. So when you ask them about pricing and they toss out some numbers to you, you want to say, well, why did you come up with that number? Tell me more. Show me more, and then collaboratively work through that with the agent. And hand in hand comes with not only what your house might be worth, but how can you sell it? What is the best strategy to sell your property in today's crazy market? Is it to list lower than its value and have an offer date? And if so, why would that be a good strategy? Is it smart to list a little bit higher and negotiate with parties one-on-one? And if so, why would that be a great strategy? And show backup for that, please. Or the third might be like, let's list for what the property we all feel, what it's worth, and perhaps ask for a longer irrevocable on offers to see if we might get multiple bids. Again, depending on what it is, the price that you're in, the neighborhood you're in, and the asset class that you have. So the big thing here is working through pricing and strategy with your potential listing agent and asking them for evidence, showing you that they have done their homework and they can back up that number. And you have to remember that any number that you work with or any price, when buyers and buyer agents are going to be looking at the potential property to purchase for themselves, they're going to be looking at that same data. So you want to have a story that you can tell that's data-centric and backed up by whether it's comparables, appreciation, compounding appreciation, or whatever methodology this potential listing agent is using. Ralph, did you want to add anything to that?
Well, Cord, do you want to talk a little bit about making adjustments? Because when you look at a value of a property, you look at past sales, past comparable sales, hopefully in the same neighborhood, same type of asset class within a reasonable period of time. Mm-hmm. But that's every house is different. Every even condo is different. And how even taking into account appreciation over a period of time, either if a property sold 6 months ago or a year and a half ago, how do you talk to me about adjustments and how does that work and why is that important?
That's a great question. So particularly in Toronto, where no house is identical to one another, unlike the suburbs. So in the suburbs, it's much more cookie cutter and you can look down the street and say 123 Main Street sold for this. I live at 122 Main Street, so my property is likely worth this because the two houses are almost the same. So in Toronto, especially in the low-rise market or the freehold market, you're never really seeing two homes that are identical, like ever. And so when in that case scenario, the listing agent should be very well versed in comparing your property to another, of course, and then Ralph, using the terminology, adjust accordingly. So for example, you have two properties on the same street. They're both 2.5-story properties. They're both built in the early 1900s, and they both have one parking spot each. But one of them has 4 bedrooms, the other has 3. One of them has a finished basement, the other does not. One has a detached garage, the other does not. So now you're seeing you're not actually comparing apples to apples here, you're actually comparing apples to oranges. And in that case, when a competent, well-versed listing agent is looking at those comps, they're going to adjust the expectation for your sale based on those differentials. So what they should be doing is actually giving a price tag to some of those changes. So for example, if you have a parking spot and one other does not, that's a differential of $50,000 to $75,000 between those two properties. So they can adjust up or down accordingly. If you have an extra bedroom versus not having an extra bedroom, that could be a spread of $50,000 to $70,000 depending on the total bedroom count. So a competent agent should be able to showcase you these comparable homes and then show you exactly how they adjusted to come up with their price based on the past recent sales. Was that a good explanation, Ralph?
That was excellent. And the same would apply to a condo, but to a lesser extent. So you might have two condos, similar size square footage, same building, same relative time frame that we're looking at from a sale and a potential sale of another property, but one may have a better exposure, one may have outdoor space, one might have a locker, one might have upgrades. And so again, you have to adjust up or down when looking at valuation. And a lot of agents and a lot of homeowners fail to make these types of adjustments when trying to assess a value of their own property.
Yes. I think a really big one too right now that we're looking at a lot when we do a comps is obviously lot size is really important, but then what is the potential value down the road? Is there a way to add value to this property? And examples being, would this property qualify for a garden suite? Would this property qualify for a laneway house? Or is there potential to do an extension or a third floor down the road based on what's happening in the local neighborhood? And that can add a lot of potential future value to a property when buyers are looking at it, knowing they're making a huge investment in Toronto, but they want to know that, yes, they can depend on some appreciation, but they can put some money into the property and see a strong ROI in 10, 15 years as an example.
Awesome. Okay, well, I think that's a really extensive answer to the question. But to wrap it up, I think it's really important when working with or considering working with a listing agent to understand that they have the skill and the expertise to assess a proper value of your property, because in a market where it's as challenged like it is today, you only really get one shot for your first time on the market. And so you want to get it right the first time. You don't want to have to keep doing price reductions, or you don't want to sell at a price that one day you may regret thinking maybe I could have gotten more. So you really want to understand the logic that goes behind it. And also a really good agent will have instinct and they'll be like, you know, I've been doing this for a long time, or I've done a lot of transactions in this specific area, or I'm on a team and I've got a lot of agents and I'm noticing this trend. And I'm feeling that even though this is the range, we might be able to get a little more, or maybe we might be able to get a little less. But there's also a certain amount of instinct that goes along with that experience.
Yeah, so true.
Okay. So let's move on to question number 2.
Okay.
What, and this is a good one for you, Corey, what is your marketing strategy?
oh, this is huge. This is massive. This is everything. Beyond price, this particular piece is everything. And you do want to ask this question because it's not the same for every agent. It truly is not. And there's different standards within this realm as well. So you want to ask, what is your marketing strategy? And then ask them to walk you through what that looks like. And so for us here at Fox Marin, that includes a multi-level approach, both digital and in print. So you want to ensure that the agent has a fabulous photographer. Ask for examples of their work. You want to ensure that they have a great videographer. Ask for examples of their work. You want to see that they have a great online presence, including a website that can showcase your property at its highest and best. And then you want to ask them, what else are you going to do beyond the obvious? And those things include exceptional copywriting as examples, neighborhood profiles, school ratings. Other marketing materials would include speaking to the potential value of the house down the road, the upgrades done to the property, the research done to the property, the history of the home. All of these pieces are collected as pieces of a wonderful story that you want the agent to create about your home. And they're going to gather all of this, is going to gather all of this information and make sure it's available to buyers, buyer agents, so that they feel really confident about what is presented to them. And so you have to remember too, and it's such a huge thing, and we talk about this with all of our clients all the time, that people are searching for their new condo or their new home literally while they're on the go. Like they are flipping through their realtor.ca app or their House Sigma app while they're standing in line at Starbucks waiting for their venti cappuccino. And they're literally swiping left through these apps quickly. Like we actually have no attention span anymore, it seems like. So we really need to ensure, or at least we do, we want to ensure that that first hero image or that first image in your carousel really encourages, inspires people, buyers, to stop and drop and do something. So they're like, oh my gosh, this home looks so beautiful. Or, oh gosh, this condo looks so interesting. I want to know more. So a good agent's going to focus a lot on that photography piece, including that first hero image, which makes me even want to talk a little bit deeper. And I believe this is another question that we're going to address, but you're also going to want to talk about what their marketing, what their staging and styling plan will be. But we'll talk about that as a separate question, but that integrates into marketing. So not only are we speaking about all of this research and education that we want to bring to the table when it comes to a listing, we also want to make sure that the listing agent has a wonderful online digital footprint. So I mentioned briefly the website, but we also want to make sure, or you want to make sure, that the agent has a strong social media presence as well. This is absolutely huge, more so than ever before, as I'm sure you can imagine. But you want to make sure that they have up-to-date profiles, whether it's Instagram or Facebook or LinkedIn or whatever platform they use to tell their client stories. You want to make sure it's robust, it's up to date, it's visually impactful, it's beautiful, and it gets out there to a larger audience so that your home gets in front of as many eyeballs as possible. You might even ask them about sponsored digital advertising at this point. You might also ask them about international advertising at this point, or you might ask them about how you might advertise to other cities in Toronto as well, because we know a lot of people are coming and going from Toronto because it's such a big financial hub for work. So these are all really important questions you want to ask. And then lastly, you also want to ask, do they do anything in print? So do they have a feature sheet that's left at the property? Do they have floor plans available for our potential buyers when they come see the property? Why is that important? And if so, and they do it, ask for examples. So people can talk a lot of talk. You want to see, again, that evidence that they actually follow through with everything that they say that they do about marketing.
Awesome. I think social media is so important because it's such an amazing way to tell the story of a property and be able to interact with people who may not actively been looking, who may at one point have been looking, who may have people who live, reach people who live in the neighborhood, who are trying to entice other friends or family to buy in their neighborhood. There are just so many ways that you can have this reach, which goes well beyond MLS or realtor.ca, from people who are actively looking. So how are you able to cast that net? And again, going back to the importance of that website, having a great website is that MLS and realtor.ca are so dated and there's only so much you can tell a story. And It is so important because people, buyers more than ever, do so much research before they go to look at a property or even reach out to their agent. And so having the tools to be able to tell your story in the best possible light is super important. And a good agent in most instances will be able to get more traction on their website than MLS and realtor.ca. And the days of just taking an upside down picture on realtor.ca and just thinking that that is going to bring you buyers, especially in a market like this, those days are just long, long gone. And so that's why people have to be more considerate with who is selling, who is marketing, and who is negotiating their properties on their behalf.
Yes, because you might only find one buyer in like a haystack right now.
Yes.
And so we want to make sure that everything is so curated so you can find that one person. We don't necessarily have 20 people lining up at your condo or 20 people lining up for your low-rise home in Riverdale like we did 2, 3, 4 years ago. So it is imperative that you maximize your marketing potential because it only does take one. And I know from the last year that we sold a lot of properties over the last year in a very volatile, challenging market, that a lot of the time it only has come down to that one person that has put an offer in, and then we've just grinded out a negotiation with them. But they found us, they found the seller's property, and they felt confident enough to move forward when they had the pick of the litter with so much inventory out there and a lot of opportunities for them to go somewhere else. So make your place as special as possible, and marketing is the way to do that.
Awesome. Okay, let's move on to question number 3. How do you approach staging and styling?
Yes. Well, this is an add-on to marketing, and this is an absolute must-do. Never underestimate the power of staging and styling at all. And I think a lot of people think it's fluffy or it's too much of an investment or too much work. It absolutely, hands down, will make a difference. So for those of you who might not really know what the terminology is, this is when properties are given like a really nice makeover before the photos are taken for their listing. So whether it's the listing agents themselves or they work with a team of stagers or stylists that come in, they come and maximize your property's look, feel, and aesthetic. And they'll do that through various ways: furniture, art, florals, plants, pillows, linens, everything that you could imagine that would make your home feel more inviting, warmer, more contemporary, bigger, cleaner, appealing, photograph better. These are all of the responsibilities of the staging and styling component of your marketing materials and storytelling. And I can't even tell you that, and you're welcome to check out some of our before and afters on our website, but I can't even begin to tell you how we have transformed the most generic property and made it something special using this tool, or a place that's just cluttered from top to bottom with stuff, and how decluttering it, painting it white, giving it some fresh light fixtures, and then bringing in the furniture and the decor pieces, and now you've got a brand new, very vibrant character home coming from what you could just imagine as practically looking like a hoarder's home. So all of this makes such an impact in two ways. One, it actually makes a difference to how your photos look, which is the key to getting buyers into the door. So Your staging and styling is going to make a massive impact on your video and your photos, which you need to ensure are perfect and beautiful and enticing. And the second is going to make a massive difference to people walking through the property. We want them to feel that they can imagine themselves living in the space. They feel emotionally connected. They start thinking about where they're going to put their own personal decor pieces or hang their art. They need to have 15% of the population can visualize. The other 85% cannot. So you've got to do this work for them. And so it's a bit of a grind to get your property ready for sale when you go down this route. But in today's market, you have no other choice but to explore this.
It's a saying that we have at Fox Marin: people buy on emotion and then they justify with logic afterwards. And it is so, so, so important when somebody walks into your property and it's on the market that they make that emotional connection to the property, that they can visualize themselves living there, that there is something there that makes them want to actually live there or invest there or own the specific property. It is just so, so, so important. And, you know, there is a real difference between good staging and bad staging.
Yes.
And bad staging becomes such a distraction to the property that it will actually detract buyers from the property. Corey, do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yes. So when you're interviewing listing agents for your property, I want you to ask for examples of their staging before and after pictures. This is going to give you a really good example of the look and feel and the aesthetic they bring, that they bring forward on behalf of your property. And you really, really, really do want to ask for that, because as Ralph mentioned, there's a huge difference between good staging or excellent staging and horrible staging. And I can't even imagine, there's like thousands of staging companies in Toronto. Like, it shocks me how much I am e-blasted every day from different staging companies that are trying to elicit business from us. And bad staging, it's hard to like describe it unless you really know it, but I'm going to give you some examples of it. It's dated. I think that's the number one. It's less curated. It looks cheap. It looks like furniture has not had a lot of turnover. So the staging company hasn't invested in their inventory, and they're using inventory from, let's say, 10 years ago.
What are your thoughts on chrome?
Yeah. So I'm going to get there. So like some telltale signs would be a lot of chrome, like chrome feet on the coffee tables, a lot of mirrored glass on side tables or end tables. Plastic fruit would be another example. Canvas art is another example. So something that you would find at, no diss to HomeSense. We love HomeSense, but something you'd see at HomeSense that's like a canvas piece with like maybe an abstract painting on it. That would be another sign. Color palette is dated. Anything that's very blingy does not work in Toronto at all. People are much more demure here. So bling does not really work. And as much as I like color, and I know it's hard to imagine when I'm always wearing black, you're going to want to work with like a softer, more warm color palette versus like seeing things like red or orange or a lot of patterns that do not shoot well in photography. So those are some key differentials between good staging and bad staging.
For sure. You never want to distract. You want to enhance.
Yes.
So that's super important. Very, very, very important aspect to the whole process. Okay, so let's get into question number four. How do you ensure transparent and honest communication?
So I think it's really interesting that according to the National Association of Realtors in the U.S., the number one complaint from clients about their agents is that they never hear from their realtor, which I find absolutely bizarre, because we talk personally with our selling clients all day, every day, from the moment that we are engaged with them to the moment that the property actually closes, not sells, but closes. So we're in touch with them for maybe like 3 to 4 months straight, every day, all the time. And it's absolutely imperative to us that they know what's going on. So this means communication to another level. So Let's say we're in the preparatory period. I want them to know what the schedule is like. When should they expect the cleaners to arrive? What's happening with the electrician? Oh, we came up with a few speed bumps in your home inspection. How can we resolve this? Being very transparent about all of the prep work with them so they know what's going on. And if we have to solve problems together, they're in the know. So we're keeping everything like an open book with the sellers from day number one. And then as we move to the listing side and they're actually on MLS, we're reporting in with them regularly to tell them how many people have gone through the property. What is the feedback from agents? Are people attending the open houses? Who's looking at the website? Who's looking at their social media? How many people are clicking on realtor.ca? And they're actually getting reports about what's happening from an analytical perspective, but they're also hearing all of the real-time feedback, the juicy tidbits that we're getting from agents, and we're sharing the good, the bad, the ugly. We want the sellers to know what people are saying so that we can problem solve through it. And then, of course, obviously, as we start negotiations and offers come through, this is the part where you need and must have that open and honest and trust in each other to be able to work collaboratively to come to a win-win result, especially in a market right now where it's just not so easy to sit back and wait for 10 offers to come in your property. You might just get one really shitty offer, like shitty offer with conditions and a price that might be disappointing and a closing that's 90 days away. So if you've built up trust and rapport and honest communication with this client from day one, when you get to that really challenging part, it makes it a lot easier to have a very open conversation about how to move forward and create a win for that client. So I can tell you with all transparency on my side, over the last year and a half, Ralph and I have had the hardest conversations we've ever had to have with clients just because the market has been so unpredictable. And in a way, this market's just made us better agents because we've had to dig deep. We've had to find solutions. We've had to tell them hard things. We've had to tell them when things aren't working. We've had to tell them about shitty offers that have come in. And the thing that I've taken away from that is by just being honest about it and being like, it is what it is. What can we do to solve this? It just makes everything so much easier and breezier. And you will find a way through this as long as you've started that from the get-go with your listing agent.
That's awesome. And a couple of things that I come to mind is if you feel that somebody's being high pressure with you, trust that gut feeling. If you feel that somebody is being short with you or not respectful for you or of your time, or they're not listening to you, trust your gut. You really want to be able to communicate openly with somebody and not feel pressured and not feel like they don't have the time, or more importantly, that they're not listening or that they don't really care or aren't invested.
Yes.
And so those are real important things that you want to look for. As you were saying, Corey, it is a really challenging market and you just want to make sure that the people that you choose to work with and go through this odyssey with in this market, that you really can communicate with and that they're listening to you, they're invested in your personal success and in the outcome, and that they have what it takes to get you to where you need to be in terms of how they work with you. Super, yes. Super, super important. And the other thing is at Fox Marin, we have this mantra, time kills deals. Mm-hmm. And so response time is going to be really important, because if they, as your potential client or client, can't respond to you and get back to you almost right away, what are they going to do when they have an offer or a buyer or somebody has a question about the property? So you really want to make sure that whoever you're working with or considering working with is that they are excellent, effective communicators.
Yes. And you want to feel like you can trust them to tell you so that you can tell them stuff. Like, I want people to feel like they can call me and be like, I feel really stressed. My property hasn't sold yet. I just wanted to call you and vent. Or I wanted to call you because I wasn't really happy with the way what the cleaners did. I didn't like the cleaning job. I just wanted to tell you, it's not a big deal, Corey, but I wanted to let you know in case you didn't want to partner with these people ever again. Or, you know, I'm out of town this weekend and there's a massive snowstorm and now I can't shovel my driveway. Do you have somebody on your team that could pop by? I hate to ask. Whatever it is,
I'm totally stressed and I didn't sleep last night because I'm really, really, really worried, or I'm under financial duress.
Yes, all of those things. I've never felt like, oh my God, I can't believe this seller is telling us this. I feel like we are in the trenches with our clients all the way until the closing date. Mm-hmm. And so it's really, really important. And it can be actually way more fun if you do have this level of communication, because things just get so crazy sometimes. You're like, I can't even believe this is happening. So it actually makes it more fun if you have that type of partnership with your sellers.
So let's get into question five. What professional network and resources and infrastructure do you have? And I think it's really, really important when you're considering working with an agent or a team is to really understand how deep of bench strength do they have? So let's say your listing agent gets sick or they have a personal emergency. Who's going to be able to fill in? Let's say they're away on showings or busy and a problem happens. Who's going to be able to jump in to ensure that everything is smooth? So do they have infrastructure and do they have a really good network to support the entire process? The days of a one-man show are becoming more and more challenged because this business is becoming so much more nuanced and moving quicker and quicker and quicker. You as a seller deserve to have the very best representing you, and you want to make sure that the ball never, ever gets dropped. Another important aspect to that is, you know, what type of a network do they have and what type of reputation do they have? Do they have a great reputation in the area and in the city working with other agents? This is all very much a relationship-based business. And it's not just even when you're working with clients, but when you're working with other agents. There are some agents who have a terrible reputation and you see a great property coming up and their name's on the listing and you're like, oh my God, I don't want to have to deal with them. So make sure that whoever is representing you has an impeccable reputation, has a really good agent network, and also really is able to help partner you or put you in touch with a good mortgage broker, a good contractor, so that any work that pops up can be dealt with, in home inspectors, lawyers, and so that they can provide a seamless experience. And we talked about communication earlier. If they're able to refer other great partners to you who can work at a high level, then everything starts to become integrated and things become more seamless. And again, you're not dropping the ball. And this is such a multifaceted business. You really want to have everything as buttoned down as possible.
I say this all the time, every day. I could not do this job at this level without the team that we have. And that goes beyond the agents themselves. That goes to everybody working on the back end, whether that means it's our listing coordinator, our marketing coordinator, obviously the other agents, but then all of those amazing third parties that we work with as well, like our movers and our stylists and the cleaners and the photographers and the photo editors. I mean, it's exceptional to think how many people actually touch that property before that first image hits MLS. So could not agree with that more.
It takes a village to sell a property.
Does. It does.
Especially in Toronto. Question number six, what are communication and negotiation skills? And I think this is a real important question and something for a seller to be thinking about is when the crunch moment comes, who do you want representing you and negotiating the sale of your property? Like everything is awful, but that 11th hour, that one conversation sometimes, or that one strategic decision can really shape the difference between a property selling and not proper selling, a record sale and a not record sale. And so really try to drill down, like ask for stories about when they've exercised negotiation skills and how they were successful in that moment and what they did in high stress situations, and to give examples and anecdotes of how they've dealt and worked through those type of situations, and then see and feel if that resonates with you. And, you know, we've seen so many situations where it's like, oh my God, if that buyer or seller knew what this agent was saying or not saying or doing or not doing, they would be devastated. And so it's really important that you try and see in the future as a seller that clutch moment or those conversations are in the right possible hands.
Yes. And I think this also comes down to strategy as well. So yes, strong negotiation skills and clear communication capabilities are huge. And then, as you mentioned earlier, everything is so nuanced. So the agent needs to be really tactile when it comes to things like, when should we sign the offer back? How long of an irrevocable do we want on this? Do we want to make any strategic changes to the terms and conditions? What can we ask for here? What can we take away here? So there's like a push-pull that happens in the negotiation beyond the verbal aspect of negotiating. And it comes down to like a little bit of a science. Like, does it make sense for us to send the offer back tonight at 10 p.m.?
Yes.
Or does it make more sense for us to send this tomorrow morning at 8 a.m.? And why? And like checks and balances on those things. And this can all come down to things like, is it going to be a weekend coming up? There's a stat holiday that might affect when these conditions could be waived. How quickly can they get a home inspector in there? What is the seller's ability to manage risk or stress? And like, how can we reduce that for the seller by managing this negotiation this way? And then the last thing I want to say about negotiation beyond those like little nuanced pieces is that being an asshole does not help get deals done. Like, I just think people see too much reality TV and think that negotiation is all about being like a power broker and like having your cell phone and pacing back and forth and yelling. And actually, deals get done when both parties are super respectful of one another and are just be like, this is the problem here. I'm looking to solve it. You are my partner on the other side. How can we get this done? And like, if you have somebody on the other side that can speak to you in that language, the negotiation is going to be so much easier. But please, agents, you don't need to be like running out there as if you're pretending to be a character in some Hollywood film.
Yeah, like Ari Gold.
Yeah, like no Ari Golds here.
No.
If anyone okay. Ari Golded me, I would be like, okay, call me later.
Okay, question number 7. What is your proven track record? Cora, I'll let you handle this one.
Yes. So don't be afraid of asking the listing agent for this exact thing. So this means asking them for their stats. How many properties have they sold? Have they sold in your area before? How long have they been in the business? What percentage of deals do they do in the GTA or Toronto compared to other agents? They should be able to have all this data available for you on your listing meeting. And I think they should be able to bring up case studies as well and talk about, oh, I sold another home in Corso Italia, and this is what we did, and this is the success model that we had, and this is how we achieved this great results, how we achieved these great results. So I don't think there's any shame in asking for this, and an agent should be able to prove their value using stats. And like, there's a lot of great talkers out there, and a lot of people can schmooze and be very charming, but at the end of the day, you want, again, an evidence-based answer.
Well, I think that really just wraps it all up, right, with a bow right around it. Thank you so much, Corey. I think the one pro tip that we will give, interview. Like, talk to other agents, do your research. You know, I think people sometimes will spend more time planning a 2-week trip to Mexico than they will thinking about who they're going to hire and who they're going to have represent them to sell their most prized asset and to buy their most prized asset. We're talking millions and millions of dollars, and people sometimes will just go with the first person they end up speaking with. Do your research. And that's really it. So I think we really did a great job, Corey, covering the top 7 considerations when hiring a listing agent. And I hope our viewers got some value out of what we were able to share today.
I hope they did too. And if you enjoyed this episode, please, please, please don't forget to like, subscribe, or comment below with your thoughts or your questions. And again, I'll make sure that I post the 7 questions that you should be asking your listing agent when looking for a rock star to sell your property in Toronto's volatile, crazy market that we're in right now. Thank you so much for joining us, Ralph. It's always a pleasure to talk to you, and I'm sure I'll talk to you about 80 times again today.
Likewise.
And viewers, thank you so much for tuning in. We really appreciate you.
Please be sure to hit that like or subscribe button. And if you have any comments, we'd absolutely love to hear from you. Any questions, feel free to reach out at any time.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye-bye.